Andrew from Creative Guitar Studio, and this week I had a question emailed to me from George in Barton Hill, England, and he's asking, can you give me a good idea of what is involved with learning to play jazz? I've read that there are common chord changes to jazz music, and to get good at the style, there are quite a number of chords to know. A video on what chords are important, as well as what chord progressions I can begin to practice, would really help me a great deal. So thanks for the question, George, appreciate it. And basically, you know, starting off, you know, at the beginning of your question on what chords are important, basically all of them to play jazz. But let me just get a little more, serious about that. All of your triads, so start off with understanding at least three or four ways of how to play all your major, minor, augmented, and diminished triads along your neck. A very good way to practice that is to do harmony exercises, you know, take a scale and just harmonize a scale along your whole fretboard. You know, take it very linear. I've done a couple of videos on harmonizing triads and seventh chords along the neck, so you can just look for those on my YouTube channel. The other thing that I would suggest to move on to after that, if you get a pretty good, decent level of skill with the triads, is to go to seventh quality chords. So you'll want to study your major, minor, seven, and major seven, minor seven, dominant seventh, and minor seven flat five, which is a chord that's often called half diminished, as well as your fully diminished seventh chord. So you got basically five seventh chords to get a decent handle on, and same thing, you know, be able to learn at least three to four voicings on your fretboard for those chords. Like a great way to practice that too is to pick a chord, like let's say you pick G minor seven, you know, you want to make a thorough examination of that. So what I would suggest doing just as a basic practice tool is try and get a voicing together for yourself between open and fifth frets for the G minor, and then move along trying to go between fifth fret and 10th fret, find yourself a voicing, and then maybe go up between 10th and 15th and try and find a voicing. So that's three different ones, and you know, kind of scoping out three regions of the fretboard there, open to fifth, fifth to 10th, and then 10th to 15th. That's a pretty darn good way to get started with this stuff. And if you can, you know, just find at least three, let's say, voicings to start off with, you'll get other ones. You know, if you flip through some books and scan through the net, do some Google searches and touch base with some different websites and so forth, I'm sure you'll get quite a few different voicings. And eventually I'll have a handout, of course, for this video, like I, you know, usually do with these YouTube postings. So just watch for that. I'm kind of bogged down with a lot of stuff going on in the studio right now with curriculum, as well as a lot of website details. So give me about a week and a half to 2 weeks to get all the material up online. But definitely, that's the place to start. Get those seventh chords together, get your triads together. And then after that, you'll want to start working a little bit on extended chords. So getting into the world of a lot of the compound interval stuff. So, if you have a minor chord, let's say A minor 7, learn how to make it, A minor 9. Know how to go into minor 11, know how to make a minor 13. So, that kind of stuff is kind of important. You know, 9th and 11ths and 13ths, you want to get a pretty solid handle on those voicings for the majors and the minors and the dominants. Once you got that stuff down, the final category of chords to really begin examining thoroughly are all the altered chords. So, all the chords that are the dominants with the sharp 9, flat 9, sharp 5, flat 5. And their enharmonic equivalents like sharp 11 or flat 13. So you'll want to get to become familiar with those shapes on the neck as well. And same kind of philosophy of practice, find yourself multiple areas of the neck to play the chords. Another good thing for practicing chords that you can do is to scope the chord out off of the sixth string, having a root, the fifth string root, as well as the fourth string root. I know a lot of players that have gotten pretty decent at just knowing, chord voicings off of those three bass strings, and they do very well, for themselves in playing over jazz standards and some of the classic tunes. So anyways, that's that department. Let's move on to what I'm going to cover as basically the common jazz situations that you'll see out there. I want to start with probably the most common, which is referred to as the 2-5-1. And for giving you a demonstration of this, we'll go into the key of A major. And what we'll be doing is a 2-5-1 in that key. So using all seventh chords, of course, more of the jazz harmony style. So we're going to go B minor 7, and then we're going to move over to E dominant 7. And then we're going to resolve on an A major 7. So that's the 2-5-1. And you'll want to practice it in basically two ways, like sort of a long version where you'll have a chord per measure. So 1, 2, and 3, and 4, and 1, 2, and 3, and 4, and 1. Okay, So that's sort of the long version. And then practice it as a shorter version too, where you'll have the 2-5 in one measure. So it'll be like 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1. Just like so. So that's sort of like a two-measure phrase with the 2-5-1 progression. So that just covered major, though. Let's go also and cover minor. If we were in the key of A minor, we'd have a two chord of B minor 7 flat 5, or half diminished, and then we go to an E dominant 7th chord, and then we'd resolve, of course, to the A minor 7 chord, and you could have the long version of that. Shorter version of that, 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1. Okay, so that's the minor 2-5-1. Now let's move over to basically another very common progression called the 3-6-2-5. And to do this one, we'll just stay in the key of A major. We'll use a C sharp minor for our 3 chord, and then for the 6 chord, we'll be using F sharp minor, and then the 2 chords B minor 7, and then the 5 chord is E dominant 7th. So we'll do a long version of that, where we'll have one chord per measure, something like this. 2, 3, and 4, and 1, 2, and 3, and 4, and 1, 2, and 3, and 4, and 1. Okay, and then do a shorter version of that as well, where you're just really going to break it down to being a two-measure phrase. Here we go, something like this. 3, 4, and 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, and 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, and 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, and 1, and 2, and 3. Okay. And you can play those in multiple locations around your neck. You know, try and maybe just start in different areas. Like, let's say I was starting with a voicing, you know, right here off of the 4th position for C. But maybe, you know, change the voicing up, do a different voicing for the C sharp minor. Maybe, you know, start with that one and move to this 6th chord, this F sharp minor 7. And then, you know, you have your B, your 2 chord. And then, you know, just going to your 5, you could do your 5 chord maybe off of some open strings there. Or you could do it as a fretted voicing there off of the 2nd position. So, you know, if you sort of stretch yourself to be able to go and put these in various locations, it'll just keep hammering home, you know, more voicings for you and more fingerings on your fingerboard to be able to get very, you know, proficient at these changes. Now let's move on to some ideas that would basically be non-resolving 2-5s, where you don't actually head to 1. And to practice those, I think a good technique is to sort of just cycle them down the neck. I usually just tell students to do whole steps, something like that. Resolve it if it, you know, feels better to finally resolve it when you run out of frets down there. That's cool. But cycle, you know, off of the 6th string, do some of those, 5th string and 4th string. Just move them all over the place and you know, practice those non-resolving 2-5s and do them, you know, as a long version and a short version. You know, so have a set that's like a full measure on each chord, where it's like 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. So stretch them out a little bit, and then, you know, the first time I played that, I played it more where I was playing, you know, 2 chords per measure. But vary that a little bit, have yourself a long version and a short version of those phrases. And then finally, what I would suggest to look at is more of another 3-6-2-5 concept, but this time doing it with more sort of like treating it like a bebop bridge section, where all the chords are just basically dominant sevenths. So if we went back around the key center of A, we'd start with not a C sharp minor 7 chord, but we'd start with a C sharp dominant 7th chord. And then we'd go to the F sharp as a dominant 7th as well, and then the B would be dominant 7th, and the E would be dominant 7th. So that's just another 3-6-2-5, but this time we're doing all of them as dominant 7th chords. And that's quite a good exercise. Treat it the same, you know, find multiple locations, you know, maybe do it over here. We were talking about going into this position here. And, you know, try other locations as well. But I think those various ideas for practicing, are very important because they're the extremely common jazz situations that are out there. And you can start with those and you'll get your voicings for your seventh quality chords, maybe start slowly, popping in some of the extended chords like nines and 11s and 13s. You'll get a really good handle of your common jazz changes along the neck. And that's pretty much about it. So, thanks very much to George for the question, and I hope it's enlightened a few other people out there. And keep sending in the questions off of the YouTube channel and my websites. Appreciate them for doing topics for these videos. So until next time, take it easy, keep practicing, and we'll catch up with you on the next video. Take care now. We'll see you next time. Bye.